Good morning and welcome to Carroll School Special Visitors Day. We are going to get started in about 5 minutes. We have 305 special visitors joining us this morning, so it's going to take a couple minutes to get in. As you're joining us this morning, it'd be great if you would put in the chat where you're joining us from. I've heard rumors that we might have some guests as far away as Milan or possibly up in Canada. So we'd love to know where you're joining us from. Maybe a few of you are coming from the UK. If you also have any questions for any of our presenters today, you can also use the Q&A feature, which is also down at the bottom of your screen. This is fantastic. I see we already have Hudson, New York, Cambridge, Massachusetts, Santa Rosa, California. That's actually my hometown. Welcome from New Rochelle, New York, Fairfield, Ohio. This is so great to see so many of you here today. Our numbers are climbing quickly. It's amazing how we can all get started on what here in Massachusetts is a rather rainy morning. We'll just wait a few more minutes. And if you've just joined us, please do feel free to use the Q&A to write any questions you might have, things you want to learn today, things that have been at the back of your mind about a school like Carroll that you'd like to learn. And as you see in our chat feature, we've asked, as you arrive, just let us know where you're coming from this morning. And thank you so much for being here and joining us at Carroll School. We will begin in just a few more minutes. Portland, Oregon. Yes, it is probably very early on your side of the country this morning. I see that it looks like our numbers are still climbing just a little bit, so we'll probably go about one more minute and then begin this morning's presentation. It is so wonderful to have so many of you joining us as special visitors. Carroll is a phenomenal school. I'm looking forward to having you hear from so many of our leaders here at the school. Please, if you do have questions, feel free to send us the question through the Q&A feature. I won't be answering or sending answers through the Q&A. Those questions will then be posed later in the presentation to our division heads for them to share their perspective. Welcome from Ireland. So we are looking forward to hearing your thoughts and questions. Feel free to use the Q&A to ask a question you might have. Looks like our numbers are beginning to even out. So we're going to go ahead and begin this morning's presentation. My name is Kelly Fantaglossi. I am the Director of Annual Giving here at Carroll School. I am very grateful and blessed to be able to have the opportunity to introduce our first speaker this morning, Steve Wilkins. He has been the head of school here at Carroll for the last 16 years and has led us with humor and compassion and empathy through this last really interesting year of education. Just a last reminder for anyone who's just joined us, use the Q&A. And now I would like to introduce Head of School Steve Wilkins to begin our presentation for this morning. Thank you so much.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning, special visitors. Thank you, Kelly. This is our first global Special Visitors Day that we've ever had, watching where you're all checking in from. Pre-pandemic, we'd all be in person in a gymnasium at Carroll. So this does have some advantages. I was hoping we'd see somebody chiming in from the International Space Station, but we haven't gone intergalactic yet with our special visitors. but this is pretty darn cool. So we welcome you. We're able to accomplish today lots of things that we would accomplish if this was an in-person event. You have an opportunity to learn about this unique school, about your special friends at Carroll and their unique learning profiles. You can learn today what it takes to run a very complex school that's complex enough to deal with complex learners. And the only thing we're really not able to do today is to have you spend time with your favorite Carroll friend. But other than that, I think we'll do a really good job of introducing you to Carroll School and why this is so different than typical schools. If we were all in person today, typically I would start with this silly question, which is raise your hand if you went to school as a child. And obviously there's a little bit of giggling and chuckling and people wondering if the head of school's lost his mind. But my follow-up point to that is the fact that you went to school as a kid probably doesn't inform you a great deal about what the experience of being a student at Carroll School is. So I'm gonna talk to you for 15 or 20 minutes about unique features of Carroll and how this is really so different than what we all experienced when we were students in school. The advantage of today is I can do this in a very concise way. Another advantage is we're seeing 270 participants in this call. So we have a great reach to be able to talk to so many of you. So I'm gonna start off talking about a number of topics in terms of Carroll's unique approach, our unique approach to education and understanding of who our students are. I'll talk to you a little bit about the strength within the Carroll School program and the institution of Carroll. And then we are going to hear from some of our faculty via video about the projects they're engaged in with your special Carroll friends. And then we will move over, we'll hear a little video from kids as well. We'll move over to question and answer with our three division heads. And Carroll's a three campus school, a lower school led by Sue Kingman, middle school led by Allison West, and upper school led by Kate Collins. So that's our basic program for this hour that we will spend with you. So I'll jump right in. I'm gonna talk to you about this unique capacity that Carroll School has to educate children who do not necessarily thrive in traditional schools. So the big question is, why do students thrive at Carroll, whereas they may not have at other places? Some kids come to Carroll very much socially and emotionally intact, and others come to Carroll really having been devastated by their lack of success in traditional environments. And we'll talk about that a little bit. How is it that we can succeed where other schools fail? And what's the number one factor in student success? And that's your question of the day for you to ponder. What is the number one reason that children succeed in their education? And there's been all sorts of research done internationally about this. And there's actually a very surprising answer to it. And then I'll finish up a little bit about talking about if not for Carroll and our institutional strength. So first question, why do students thrive at Carroll, whereas they might not have been thriving before they came to Carroll? And the answer is to us fairly straightforward and immensely complicated. Because we give each child what they most need, we believe that our mission, our reason for existing, is that we look at each child's learning profile, their cognitive skills, their academic skills, their social emotional makeup, and we determine what to teach them based on their profile. We give each child, you see those highlighted in red, the GEC, to create a Carroll School word called GEC. We turn it into a noun, we turn it into a verb, we talk about GECing children, which means if a child's not thriving, it's our job to adjust ourselves to give them what they most need. Traditional schools, schools that you and I went to, kind of had a set curriculum for third graders or for fifth graders or for seventh graders or for ninth graders. And teachers were told to teach that curriculum. And the result was a bell-shaped curve where some children thrived, many children did fine, and some children did not do fine at all. Prior to Carroll, so many of our students were in that last population of kids who did not respond sufficiently effectively as well as one would expect to that kind of a curriculum-driven approach. Carroll's approach says, look at the child and decide what to teach them based on their needs. That's why you'll hear this expression, we GECK. I want to describe to you a little bit about what GECK looks like. GECK is at the core of absolutely everything that Carroll School does. GECKing requires attention to the whole child. We can only GECK fully when our lens accounts for each child's unique identity and their profile in so many different ways. Back in the olden days, maybe 10 years ago, Carroll School would look at academic profile and sort of IQ cognitive profile and start building their program. In today's world, we also understand that the full range of an individual's identity, their cultural background, their family background, who they are and their previous experiences account so much into how we GECK properly. Gender considerations, race considerations, cultural considerations, all factor into this notion that Carroll School's job is to bend and adjust itself to meet the needs of each individual child. The curriculum and the teaching approaches are not the same for any kid as it is for any other kid. We change to reflect this truth and to the benefit of all of our students. Why don't all schools GECK? Why don't all schools say, you know, the old fashioned way of handing a textbook to a teacher and say, teach this and be done in June, just makes so little sense in this modern age of neuroscience and understanding individual difference. Why don't they do it? Because it's enormously complicated. And I will explain to you now how Carroll School is able to give each child what they most need. Schools would do it if it was easy. It's not easy. It's very hard. It's very complicated. And it's the unique offering of Carroll School. So how can we possibly do this? This is GECK. How can we give each child what they most need? We focus on one type of learner. America's public schools have to take all the children in a particular city or town and educate them. Carroll School is an independent school, is able to say, we are going to take one type of child, one type of learner, and focus in on them. And then we can give each child what that child most needs. As such, we become expert at teaching this type of learner. And it's not that all of our kids are the same. We have 440 students at Carroll, and we have 440 versions of bright children with language-based learning difficulties, which we often call dyslexia. So we focus on a particular type of learner and then customize our program 440 different ways for each of those children. So who is this learner? And this is a fairly complicated issue. Generally speaking, I can describe to you who each of our 440 students is in a broad context. But the word generally is up at the top of this slide because what I'm about to say does not apply 100% of the time to 100% of our students. But generally, for the most part, This is the description of a Carroll School learner. And it's the description of a child whose profile looks a little bit like this chart. It looks maybe a little bit like the profile of a mountain range or a profile of the Alps, with significant highs, beautiful peaks, beautiful strengths, and then some valleys that are surprising within a profile of a child who's generally so talented. Every student who comes to Carroll comes with a psychoeducational or neuropsychological evaluation that either has been performed by the public school system or by parents and families who have decided they're going to get an independent look into the way their children learn. The first and major component of that is an IQ test. And the IQ test or cognitive profile comes in five components. Carroll School students generally, for the most part, have way above verbal comprehension. These are children who use language extremely well. Wait a minute, Mr. Head of School, you just described Carroll as a school for children with language-based learning difficulties, and now you're saying their verbal comprehension tends to be well above average. Exactly true. To meet the typical Carroll student, and you know this from your special Carroll kid, these are smart children who use language really well. To talk to them, to listen to them think verbally, you just go, wow, what a bright little kid. How creative and innovative and interesting and able to have good conversations. It's when the reading issue enters the world of school that so many Carroll kids began to struggle. Children who were sort of champions of kindergarten and nursery school and fantastic on the playground and the sandbox, when reading entered their world and children and teachers started to define who's smart and who's not smart by how well they read in first, second, third grade, our kids started to develop this issue of, I'm not sure I'm as smart as the other kids. I don't understand why I can't read as easily as the other kids. I don't understand why all of a sudden my world is starting to collapse around me. So this high verbal comprehension is a long-term gift to our kids. But there is this confounding confusion that these really bright verbal kids struggled so much to learn how to read in the early grades. And that might persist if they don't get good instruction into the middle school years. The second component of this IQ test is called fluid reasoning. And this is kind of listening to kids think without words. Watch them solve problems in the visual spatial world. Lego kids, inventors, problem solvers, get out the cardboard and start building models. Our kids, generally speaking, are well above average in these areas. Then the next two areas become surprising weaknesses for most Carroll kids. That the reason that they have trouble learning to read and maybe learn their math facts and to do some things that are considered basic school functions is they have weak working memory. And this is documented through the assessments that are done on each of our kids. They don't hang on to information and hold it in memory while they're completing a task. Their working memory lets them down. And reading is a really good example of a working memory task, where you have to sort of remember the initial sounds as you read through the whole word. By the time you get to the end of the word, you've forgotten the beginning sounds. So working memory is a classic Carroll School problem. The next general weakness for our kids is called processing speed. And these bright, creative, innovative kids maybe don't get their hands up in the air quite as fast as the other kids in the classroom. When the teacher says, who knows the answer, that our kids are going, they're thinking deeply, but they're not necessarily thinking quickly. And again, this sends our kids into wondering whether how fast you answer a question is actually the measure of how smart you are. Whereas we know as adults, that's not the measure of intelligence. The intelligence comes through with how deeply do you consider something. But most of our kids have processing speed challenges. So they're sitting in classrooms, knowing the answer and they can't get it out as fast as their peers. And they start to wonder how smart they are or if they're not very smart at all. The fifth category is visual spatial. You see the plus minus there. It doesn't describe our kids in general ways too well. So all Carroll students have a history of phonological struggles. They have difficulty learning to read. They may now be good readers, but it didn't come easily to them. They may not be fluent. They may still continue to struggle with reading, with comprehension, with vocabulary. But I also pointed out that the definition of a Carroll kid is also significant strengths, beautiful mountain peaks. But always, 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 we focus on kids with language-based learning difficulties, such as dyslexia. Then every educational decision we make is made based on the needs of the individual student. How do we do this? Again, the answer is we focus. This visual metaphor explains a little bit of the way Carroll's set up. In the typical classroom, this is 48 students. Let's say they all live in the same town. They're all fourth graders. We're gonna find about 20% of the population has difficulty acquiring reading skills. They might be our kids, they might be dyslexic. And so the typical town would take 48 fourth graders and they would divide them into two classrooms of 24 and spread those children represented in blue, our children, Carroll School profile children, spread them into the two classrooms. The problem with this is our children in blue are still in the minority. Instruction is still gonna be directed at the children represented in orange. Carroll School's model, on the other hand, next slide, Jen, please, says, why don't we design an entire school for the children represented in blue? Why don't we design a school for bright, motivated children with language-based learning difficulties such as dyslexia? And that's what Carroll School is. And design a program that works for that type of learner. So you can see in the pie chart here, something over 50% of each child's day is spent in very specialized, what we might call remedial education. Small group language arts, and Jen, you can hit the clicker a couple times here. Small for us means 8 students maximum in a language arts class. Focus area where we really give each child what they most need would be a tutorial, or in this pandemic year, a focus area no larger than 4 students, where a teacher or a tutor is able to hone right in to the deficit areas in a child's profile and work every day to start building the skills in those areas. The same thing happens in math, where again, we're in very small groups and we are building what we call profile specific groupings. Does Carroll do ability grouping? No, we don't do ability grouping. We assume every child has plenty of ability, but we do skill grouping so that no matter what grade you're in, we can meet your needs, meet you right where you are, and start building your capacity from where you are to infinity and beyond. So a little over half of each day for Carroll children is in this very specialized, Orton-Gillingham-oriented, give each child what they most need. And then the other 40-45% of the day, this is so important, is focused on what we call dyslexic strengths, or the dyslexic advantage, which is the name of a book you might want to grab to read or to listen to, where we are working with these very bright children to accentuate their strengths in history, science, engineering, STEM kinds of activities, design. We're doing a lot of work with social justice and leadership, a lot of work in the arts and in music, outdoor education, which is called Bounders. And during this pandemic year, it's been particularly important to build happiness in kids who are experiencing a very strange world right now. And so lots of work in clubs where kids have natural strengths and interests. So the whole school is designed for a particular type of learner. We're going to show you a video here of something very unusual that Carroll School does. We believe that that profile of the ALPS, the strengths and weaknesses, that we have an obligation to try to improve the weak areas in children. And modern neuroscience is telling us that neuroplasticity, the flexibility in the brain, is such that we could improve these deficit areas. So this video does a great job of explaining cognitive intervention at Carroll.
What is targeted cognitive intervention? Bright, motivated students come to Carroll School with language-specific learning challenges such as dyslexia. These children share a similar learning profile. They struggle to read. But when we look closer, we've uncovered that there are underlying cognitive differences. Many of these students have weaknesses in one or more cognitive capacity, how their brains process, organize, and use information. Take the word bat. You probably just read that on the screen. Simple, right? But when we look at brain activity while reading bat, you get a different perspective. Brain scans reveal so much going on. This is the reading network. It links visual recognition, auditory language, and executive function areas. Not only are these regions themselves crucial, but efficient communication among them is essential for one's ability to read. Think of it as a set of roads connecting important landmarks in the brain. When the road is narrow and full of potholes or backed up with traffic, it takes longer to get from point A to point B. When neural pathways are weak or underdeveloped, the brain's capacity to benefit from instruction is diminished. Armed with this data, we set out to find a way to optimize these cognitive capacities, to pave the roads and turn those pathways into superhighways. What was our solution? Targeted cognitive intervention. Remember our bright students with dyslexia? Their brains work incredibly hard to learn. We asked, what if we could drive faster communication between different brain regions to develop a stronger, more efficient reading network? Partnering with scientists, doctors, cognitive specialists, computer geniuses, and inspired teachers, we developed a training program to do just that, targeted cognitive intervention. TCI is a data-informed educational practice designed to strengthen the reading network in the brain. It includes computer-based assessments and games, regular progress monitoring, and teacher coaching tailored to help students build a cognitive toolbox that they can carry with them throughout their lives. TCI is built to work within a school environment alongside other academic classes. So how does TCI work? Prior to training, each student is given a pre-assessment to measure cognitive functions. Our software crunches the data and we create a cognitive profile for that student. The student is then assigned to a program based on their area of greatest need. In a classroom with a teacher, the student works on a set of activities that targets his or her specific cognitive weakness. Throughout the program, the software helps teachers monitor progress and provide individualized coaching to ensure that the child stays on track. At the end of each round of TCI, a post-test is given to determine which areas have improved. Reports are accessed through the platform by teachers who can use the data in different ways to understand and support each child's unique profile. Maybe you're wondering what results we're seeing. We're so glad you asked. In addition to helping us understand individual profiles, the TCI platform allows us to study data on a group level in order to discover exciting, large-scale trends and patterns among our population. One of the things we found is that improvements in reaction time are most strongly associated with word identification, which in turn is a major predictor of oral reading fluency, a child's ability to read a passage out loud. When we combine TCI training with Carroll's highly individualized reading curriculum, the results are astounding, even to cognitive scientists. Students are moving across percentile bands in oral reading fluency, a feat that many say is not possible. Why is this important? The ability to read fluently is crucial for academic success. Most exciting for us, as a school for children who struggle with dyslexia, is that we are significantly closing the achievement gap for our students.
So as you can gather, if you went to school when you were a child, you do not necessarily have the background to understand 21st century education for bright children with dyslexia, and cognitive development is a huge part of that. We're gonna quickly scroll through the next three slides, which show Carroll School's commitment to tracking student progress. So this is called a spider chart or a radar chart, and don't worry about what's written around the outside. But as we're in towards the origin of this chart, that means that skills are in the very, very low percentiles. And so this boy, Benny, started to grow his chart, and we track all these things and communicate them with parents. By eighth grade, Benny's profile had grown substantially, and he's making meaningful progress. And that's what Carroll School's job is. We track data to make sure that we're delivering what each child most needs. So here's your quiz question for the day. What's the number one factor in student success? And typically people will say motivation. They might say socioeconomic background. They might say intelligence. They might say drive and determination. But research study after research study says the most important factor in student success in all schools around the world is the teacher. So Carroll School, next slide, Jen, believes that it is absolutely crucial that we train our teachers to a higher level than typical teachers, because our students require them to be more highly trained. So Carroll School invests enormously in teacher training. Next slide, Jen. We make sure that every teacher has a coach. Doesn't matter whether you're in your first year of teaching or your 30th year of teaching, you collaborate with others. We bring expert speakers to the attention of our faculty. We are in professional learning communities most Friday afternoons. We run a graduate program through Lesley University that's taught by Carroll experts and delivers a master's in education. We have 5 required courses for all our faculty in Carroll University. And this particular year, we focus so much on using educational technology for days when kids are not able to be on campus. So huge investment in teachers is another reason why Carroll succeeds where other schools maybe don't. Take a moment here. Obviously, Special Visitors Day is an event full of love. It's also an event where we try to support this school and have grandparents and other friends realize that this kind of education is enormously complex, and complexity brings with it, it's enormously expensive. So Carroll completed a capital campaign last June of $32 million. Which fed $7.5 million into the endowment to support faculty, $7.5 million to make sure that this school is financially accessible to families from all around Massachusetts into New Hampshire and Rhode Island, to make sure that we have facilities. We purchased the upper school campus and built a great STEM center in the middle school campus as a result of this. And $5 million from annual giving. We are so grateful to all of you for this kind of support. In this year of constant health checks, I thought maybe the metaphor of doing a health check on a particular patient called Carroll School might be interesting to our special visitors today. So from 2017, before the campaign, to 2021 as the campaign closed down. Here's what you all and many, many others have done to enable Carroll School to succeed where others do not with these very wonderful kids. Endowment has grown dramatically. We got rid of our debt. We were able to significantly increase financial aid so that Carroll School is accessible to people from different socioeconomic levels. Now moving to about a quarter of the student body receiving financial aid to attend Carroll. During these 5 years, we also, because we acquired additional facilities, were able to increase enrollment and help more children. The name of this campaign was If Not for Carroll. And then you pause and you think, wow, where would we be? So our Board of Trustees has seen it as important to continue to grow the size of the school as long as we can continue to GEC effectively. And that happened during this time. We also were able to increase the starting salary for a teacher right out of college. So the doctor looked at the patient, Carroll School, and said, you know what? For a school of 54 years old, you're doing really quite well. I don't recommend any major change of diet, exercise, or medications for my patient, Carroll School. Seem to be doing quite well. Number three, continue to operate frugally and responsibly. You know you need to seek generous philanthropy to make this kind of education possible. And you, of course, should continue to monitor your vital signs. And for a school, those are tuition levels, the amount of financial aid that we are able to confer, how we're paying our faculty and our staff, the size of the school, and make sure you continue to ask good people to support this school through fundraising activities. So at this point in Carroll's life, we are doing really quite well as an institution and really proud of the outcomes for our students. As Kelly mentioned at the beginning, this is my 16th year of being head of school, and it's also my final year. So I'm very excited to be handing the helm of this powerful little school over to Dr. Renee Greenfield, who is a superb choice the Board of Trustees have made. Renee began her teaching career at Carroll, so she already bleeds Carroll blue. She is a fellow in the Orton-Gillingham Association, which is the highest level of Orton-Gillingham approval. So she comes with great credentials that way. And she has been a coach at Carroll recently and done professional development at Carroll recently. So many people here know Renee and are thrilled that all that I have just described will continue because Renee believes this deep in her soul. It's in her DNA.
Thank you so much, Steve. There's just so much to learn about Carroll. It's hard to do it in just 30 minutes, but I hope that all of you now have maybe a couple more questions percolating in your mind. Feel free to use the Q&A, and also thank you again, Steve, for just your leadership, your thoughtfulness. As part of the staff here at the school, GEC really frames every decision we make, and now we would like to share with you how GECing frames our faculty's experience and hear what it feels like or looks like from their perspective to teach at Carroll. Jen?
Hi, special visitors. Thanks so much for joining us today. My name is Carroll Spooner. I teach beginning readers and second grade. We do many projects in language to work on oral language skills. Our latest project is an expressive and receptive language barrier type game. A barrier game is a game that involves putting a barrier between you and another player while you try to duplicate the other player's scene using verbal directions, like the game Battleship. This game involves lots of listening as well as giving and following directions. The game we created is a monster building game. One partner builds a monster in secret and then describes the monster one step at a time. The partner is trying to duplicate the monster, so when they check at the end, both monsters are the same. The student building the monster can ask clarifying questions if they're just not sure which piece is being used or where the piece goes. In order to make our game work, we all needed a set of the exact same pieces. We made bodies, arms, legs, mouths, and bonus pieces like bunny ears and a party hat. The kids even designed their own monster piece made the patterns for everyone, drew step-by-step directions, and taught the class how to make it. Your special friends are working on fine motor skills like cutting and tracing, as well as executive functioning skills. Hope you enjoyed our monsters.
Hi, special visitors. I'm Caitlin Murphy, and I'm a third grade teacher at the Carroll Lower School. And today I wanted to share a little bit about what we're doing in math in third grade. Our overarching goal is to connect math to real life, where you would use it, as well as thinking about how math connects to our history curriculum. So we've been talking about colonial America, and we've also been learning about, in particular, a whaling voyage. And so the kids have recently been creating their own captain's boxes that they would have used on their whaling voyage. And so what they had to do was they had to go on a trip and catch whales. And based on how much they caught, they earned a certain amount of money. And from that, they could use their money to help them buy the materials to make their captain's box. It was a really fun way to get the kids using adding and subtracting and multiplying, all while doing this one project together. And they had a blast seeing how those came out. And it just makes learning a little more fun.
Hi, special visitors. My name is Oso Saigi, and I'm the Director of Equity and Inclusion here at Carroll School. This year, I taught a course called Social Justice to our fourth and fifth graders in the lower school. Through this course, the goal is to give our kids an opportunity to explore their own identity through multiple lenses, such as race and ethnicity, learning styles, religion, and so much more. This course also provides a safe space for our kids to talk openly about current events, which I'm so grateful for. I started off the semester by engaging our kids in a name exploration project. The project gave our kids a chance to research the meaning behind their names, learn more about their family history, kind of ask if there's any special stories connected to their names, and it also allowed them to just show off and talk about their hobbies and things that make them unique. They took all those pieces and then created a visual representation of their identity through a name flag. And here's a quick example. This is mine. This project was really great because it gave them opportunity to just notice and appreciate the beauty of diversity and also just really understand like the importance of it as well. So all in all, you know, by exploring our own identities and learning more about the lived experience of others, it just helps us build deeper and more empathetic connections. And it also helps us really to embody our school's principles around empathy, respect, inclusion, and kindness. So it's a win-win-win.
Hi, my name is Kelly Sampar, and I am a fifth grade science teacher down here at the lower school, where our biggest project in fifth grade is to head start cute Blandine's turtles like Scooter every year. We partner with a local conservation group, Grassroots Wildlife Conservation, to head start these endangered local turtles. And then we return them to their nesting area at the end of a 9-month period, where these guys are bigger and stronger than they would have been if they were left to nature's course. And the cool part about this project, there's so many cool parts about this project, but number one, the kids are already passionate about animals and taking care of animals. So just having the kids being enthusiastic every single day when they come to school and seeing these turtles and seeing how big they've gotten over the year is really fun in itself. But then to have them actually do science, be conservationists, again, they're not, you know, just doing fun activities, because I mean, that's fun, but they are scientists this year. They are conservationists. They are collecting data that Grassroots Wildlife Conservation uses to inform their program and to take care of turtles every single year going forward. Again, these turtles are cared for and then released back into different conservation areas like Great Meadows and Concord, where the population of Blandine's turtles is getting stronger and healthier every single year as a result of work that kids like our Carroll kids are doing.
Hi, special visitors. My name is Lisa Larsonaire, and I'm a tutor in the lower school. What you're seeing here is a slideshow that my student Brooke and I made to aid in our study of suffixes. Now, we study suffixes for two reasons. They aid in fluent decoding, comprehension, when you're really familiar with them and they're automatic. And also, we did this project to boost excitement and boost personal meaning for Brooke. She did a great job with it. And she chose the words, she chose the pictures. That was probably the most fun part. And now she has a great resource that she can go to anytime she's feeling unclear about her suffixes. Thank you.
I'm Mr. Dunkel, and I'm part of the math department here at Carroll. I've been given a little bit of time to talk to you guys today. And I've got a million things to talk to you about, but I'm gonna bring it down to one very simple thing that we do here at Carroll. We really focus in on true understanding of what we're doing in math versus that rote memorization piece. Now, we all agree that memorization is important and it's a skill for sure. But here at Carroll, one of the things that we talk about is showing your understanding. So what we do a lot of is we talk math. We do a lot of math speak, which means students from early on in the grades, when they work their way through a problem, we're constantly asking them, explain your answer, how did you get this, justify what you got, and then we talk through it. That way, teachers can really understand what students know and what they don't understand yet. That's something we spend a lot of time doing here at Carroll. And students get very good at it. Early on, there may be some shyness involved, but by the end, students are very open to this sort of understanding.
Hello, visitors. I'm Nicole Jones. I'm an English language arts teacher at the middle school, and I'm also the parent of a Carroll graduate. A big part of the focus of writing in seventh grade is learning how to write the introductory and the concluding paragraphs for an essay. Students begin this process by looking at a video clip and identifying what goes into an introductory paragraph. They then practice by sorting different sentences to try to put them in the correct order. And we look at this idea of starting from a broad topic and narrowing it down to a specific thesis statement, which is their roadmap for their essay. After that, they put their skills into practice. In a recent essay, students had to select the character they thought was the biggest hero from the book, The Outsiders by Essie Hinton. For their broad topic, students looked at the definition of a hero. Then they thought about heroes that they knew of in the real world, and they also looked at fictional heroes and heroes in books and movies as well. They then wrote a thesis statement about who they thought was the biggest hero in the book. Using pictures, images, models, and a graphic organizer really helps students understand the different parts of the introductory paragraph and understand the purpose of each sentence.
Hello, special visitors, and welcome to the virtual version of Special Visitors Day. My name is Kwame Coblin. I teach eighth grade history. And this year in the eighth grade, we've been focusing mainly on cause and effect, and focusing on how the decisions we have made in the past impact our present day. And so in the first term, we focused on identity, personal identity, and then also looking at the identity of the United States. We looked at the Civil War and the causes and effect of Reconstruction, and all the while also examining current events, specifically the presidential election. In the second term, we focused on industrialization, World War I, World War II, and then in the third term, we are going to focus on the Cold War and the Civil Rights Movement.
Welcome, special visitors. My name is Diane Francis, and this is the art room here at the middle school. We've been very creative outside, making sculptures, paintings, drawings, and prints.
Welcome, special visitors, to middle school physical education class. I'm one of the two physical education teachers here at the middle school. That's Alyssa DePaulo over my left shoulder. She's the other physical education teacher. This year, physical education has looked a little different than years past. This year, we've done a lot more individual activities, such as biking and kayaking and disc golf. Here you see a more traditional style physical education class playing floor hockey with only 8 students, and the classes are a lot smaller and able to spread out a little bit more. But we continue to work on some of the same skills, such as hand-eye coordination and work ethic and sportsmanship. So again, welcome to physical education class.
Welcome, visitors. My name is Mr. Craig Homan, and I teach 9th grade English and History at the Carroll Upper School. This year, my classes have spent a lot of time looking at the development of civilizations and world religions through literature and art. When we were learning about pre-modern China, I wanted students to actually participate in some of the activities that were part of the development of Chinese culture. We looked at some classic examples of Taoist landscape portraits and traditional Chinese calligraphy, and then students tried it out on their own. In the process, we were able to learn a lot about the development of Chinese culture. We were also able to have a lot of fun and create works of art, which the students were super proud of.
Hello, my name is Kathy Gorman. I am one of the math and science teachers at the upper school. This year, Andrew Nimmer and I teach conceptual physics. So I thought I would share some of the pictures of our students in action. We have a lot of hands-on activities to really help students see and feel the concepts in physics that are all around them. So the first set of pictures are from an inertia lab where we're teaching students Newton's first law, how objects in motion will stay in motion and objects at rest tend to want to stay at rest. And we created inertia hats using hangers and balls, and the kids were able to get them to balance on their hand because those objects wanted to stay at rest. And the kids got really creative and had a good time. I don't have any videos, but they were also able to get the balls to go in motion and orbit around their heads as well. So it was a lot of fun.
Thank you so much. I hope that each of you enjoyed hearing from our faculty. This is just a sampling of the enthusiastic, thoughtful, expert teachers that we do have here at Carroll. I just want to be thoughtful and do a quick time check for all of us. It is 9:52 on the East Coast. I know we said we'd be about an hour, and we have about 10 to 15 minutes extra. So we're looking at ending closer to 10:10, 10:15 Eastern time. So hopefully you can stay with us for the rest of the presentation we have. And what we're moving into now is questions and answers. So hopefully this will be a dynamic exchange of thoughts and ideas. Please do use the Q&A tool. It's not too late to share a question with us. And to get us started, I'd like to introduce our three school heads. We have a division head for each of our campuses. We have Sue Kingman, who's our lower school head, Allison West, our middle school head, and Kate Collins, our upper school head. They're each going to do a quick introduction about themselves and the campus that they are responsible for, and then we'll dive into some of the questions that we've received so far. Sue, why don't you start out, please?
Thank you, Kelly. Hello, everybody. So glad to have so many of you with us remotely. As Steve said, it's very cool to be able to have you so far and wide and be able to have access to this event at a time when, typically you might not have had access. So I know your children are aware of the fact that you're learning about their school, and I've heard the buzz in the hallways from kids about whether, in fact, what you all are going to see and what you're going to learn about. And I'm hoping this information will give you some conversation topics and points to talk to your special kids about. So I am the lower school division head. In the lower school here at Carroll, we serve children in grades 1 through 5. We serve about 160 children in total. And the majority of our children who start in the lower school then would transition to our middle school which is on the Lincoln campus. And I'll pass the torch to Allison to introduce herself.
Good morning, special visitors. I'm so happy to have you all join us today. As Sue said, it's so wonderful that so many of you are here. So I'm the middle school division head, and our middle school serves grades 6 through 8, and we have about 242 students enrolled in our middle school at this time. You're gonna hear in just a moment, in our upper school, there is an upper 8th. And so just to give a little bit of context, on the middle school campus, the 8th grade consists of students who have already been at Carroll. They are not new 8th graders. So when you hear Kate Collins in just a moment talk about the upper school 8th grade program, those are students who are brand new to Carroll. So I welcome you, and I'm gonna pass it over to Kate Collins.
Good morning, everyone. I am seeing the 267 people in our participants list is quite exciting, and I wish more than anything that I could also see your faces today and be together in person. Although given some of your locations, I imagine that would be quite time and consuming and maybe a bit more costly than coming here via Zoom. So I'm thrilled you're here. The upper school is located in Wayland, Massachusetts, in a quite beautiful building. If you haven't checked it out online, I recommend you spend some time looking at the space that we are inhabiting in the upper school. We are 43 students ranging from 8th and 9th grade. And as Allison said, new to Carroll 8th graders, as well as a bit larger 9th grade class that's made up of our 8th graders from the upper school who will most often transition to the 9th grade here, as well as some new to Carroll 9th graders, and some students who come to us from the 8th grade in Lincoln who will do a 9th grade year. We are in that wonderful transition time between middle and high school and really focused on preparing our students for what's next, and that being a high school experience.
So. Lovely, thank you so much, Sue, Allison, and Kate. We're gonna start diving into our questions, and we've gotten questions from sort of across the spectrum. So I think we're gonna start out at the beginning with Sue and touch on, how many kids a year do we accept? We just heard about what the construct is at each campus, but how many kids a year do we accept, and at what ages? And then what's the average length of time at Carroll before a child returns to mainstream school or different school?
Yeah, thanks, Kelly. Great question to start with. So we have, as you're understanding, a lower, middle, and upper school division. So our total admission each year is about 90 students, I would say. And they spread out between the lower, middle, and upper division. We have entry points at every grade with the exception of the departing 8th graders in the middle school. So children can come in to Carroll at any grade. They come in at the typical time at the start of the school year. But unlike other schools where a typical entry point might be already established, where they come in kindergarten, in 5th grade, and then maybe 6th grade, we have an entry for all children in every grade. And the reason for that is that our children are identified as maybe needing a school like Carroll at all different intervals and different times in their school trajectory. So therefore, we want to make sure that we've got openings and opportunity for children to be joining Carroll at various different age points. We have typically the children who are in the lower school, about 95% of them are transitioning on to the middle school campus. And so therefore a high percentage of our children are staying from lower through middle school. And then we will transition about, and I'm going to give a real range because I'm not overseeing this is in exact form, but about 75 kids each year out of our middle school program, our 8th grade, that go on to various high schools throughout the greater New England area. I think that's it.
Thanks so much, Sue. I think there's a couple of different questions that, Kate, I'm going to send over to you, and we're going to combine them. One is, you know, does Carroll plan on adding any grades after the ninth grade? And then also, how do our kids navigate after they leave the ninth grade into another school environment?
Those are two incredibly connected and wonderful questions. So to begin with, the intention to extend to further grades through 12th grade is not actually in the mission of our school. So we're rooted in preparing our students for their next academic adventure or opportunity or placement. And really with the focus that there is incredible growth in launching from this kind of Carroll bubble that will happen when a student has that experience at another school. So our current model is focused on preparing students for what's next and having that be during a middle or high school experience. And obviously for some of our younger students, could be even before that. Also that is really rooted in the science that the intervention being at the youngest possible ages is what is best for students. And of course that cannot always happen, which is why we do often place students in schools that are like Carroll, which really brings me to that next part of the question, which is how are students prepared for where they go next? And the big answer to that really is that what we're doing is finding the right school for each of our students. So as you may know, there are a range of next school options from parochial and public and other private independent boarding and day schools that are available. And our focus on preparing our students with the academic skills to excel and find success, thrive, not just survive in those environments is what we're focused on. And that is partly in preparing them with those skills and also working with the families very closely and finding that next placement that is the best fit. So Kelly, I think I got to both parts maybe together.
Did a great job, Kate. That is very helpful. And there are a number of questions about where do our students go after Carroll? And so Allison, I'm gonna have you give a quick summary, and then also touch on another piece, which I'm seeing from a couple of different individuals, which is how does the way we teach math, as well as the way that we teach reading, map as we transition children from the Carroll environment into a different school environment? So can you touch on both of those pieces?
Sure, happy to. So I would say about a third of our departing students go back to their public school, about a third go off to boarding school, and about a third will end up attending a private day school in our area. And so there's a wide variety of schools that our students tend to land at. Some schools include places like Lawrence Academy, St. Joe's Prep, Chapel Hill Chauncey Hall. We have students at Concord Academy. We do have some students who attend Landmark, Brimmer and May School, Beaver Country Day. So it is a wide variety. And what's really wonderful is we have an entire department, a placement department, whose sole responsibility is working with families to ensure that the next school is the best fit for that child. And we work with the teachers to really identify what supports, what accommodations, what programmatic elements are going to allow and ensure that this child will thrive as they move on. And to answer the question about math, Kelly, as you heard from some of our teachers, you heard from Matt Dunkel and Caitlin Murphy, we really emphasize helping students be able to think about and talk about math. And we do that by really showing students how math appears everywhere in everyday life and making real strong personal connections. We do pay attention to Massachusetts state frameworks and Common Core standards, but as you heard Steve talk about our real data-inspired approach, we're also working, teachers are working really hard to identify the gaps in foundational understanding so that we can be building a math experience, GEC, if you will, that really aims to fill and strengthen that foundation while also building students' capacity to understand those higher level math concepts. So you heard our teachers in that video talk about math talk or math speak. And we're really engaging students in a process that helps them demonstrate and show their understanding in their process. And that's yet another way for teachers to be able to assess how to tweak a math program in order to facilitate the most growth. We have a saying, a mantra that I think applies beautifully here to this question, which is we go as quickly as we can and as slowly as we need to. And I think one of the wonderful things about our smaller ratio is that we can create these homogeneous groupings and teachers can design a math experience that is truly tailored to ensuring the most meaningful progress.
Thank you so much, Allison. And just taking a peek at the clock, I think we're gonna touch on one or two more questions and then we're gonna wrap this up. And then we have one last quick video from the kids sharing with you their experience of the school. So I think that will fill in some of the gaps for any questions that are still in your heads. But Sue, I'd like to turn this question to you. It's a very thoughtful question from one of our special visitors. We know that being able to succeed academically raises confidence, as does being able to help friends solve problems together in school. But does Carroll make a specific effort to raise confidence in students so they become more adept in conversing with adults, like back and forth conversation, doing presentations, gaining that sense of confidence in themselves?
Yeah, very thoughtful question. So I would say that that question is kind of at the core of our big objective with kids. And that really is to really help for them to feel their successes, to understand their capacity, better celebrate their strengths, and not be hiding so much from their weaknesses. And for them to really better just understand what it is that they need to be successful as human beings and as students, and be reflective about that. And I think that our children, what I have this incredible ability is to see them when they come in young, maybe in second, third, or fourth grade, and then watch them graduate from us in eighth or ninth grade. And it's extraordinary, the confidence and how children are just composed and holding themselves and feeling just better understanding of who they are and what they can do. And our kids, we know our kids have utmost potential and their limitless opportunities coming their way. And through their time at Carroll, they figure that out themselves. So therefore their confidence raises enormously. And they're more comfortable with what it is that they need to do to be successful. And they are feeling more at ease with just navigating kind of their day-to-day experiences. And that confidence piece is critical, as we know, as a life skill and a sense of just identity of who am I and what do I need to do to be successful, that many folks who don't have a learning challenge ever even have the opportunity to be reflective of. And our kids are reflecting about that throughout their entire time at Carroll.
Thank you so much, Sue. Well, that is my timer letting me know that we've reached the end of our Q&A session. So for those of you whose questions we didn't get to, we will be reaching out to you individually and answering your questions, because we want to make sure we answer all questions about Carroll. And thank you so much, Sue, Allison, and Kate, for sharing your time and your thoughts. You're amazing directors. We're so lucky to have each of you here. And now we're going to share with you what our kids think about Carroll. So Jen, if you would start the video, please.
I like Carroll because it's colorful and people are nice here.
I love Carroll because it helps me feel more independent.
My favorite thing about the Carroll is their community.
The best thing about Carroll is the teachers, the students, they're all very nice. the school is just good for dyslexia and help children like me know how, like, to learn better.
My favorite thing about Carroll is the small classes.
I like Carroll because the classes are small, and if I don't understand something, the teacher can help me.
The best thing in third grade is Wailing Town.
My favorite thing about Carroll is that there are small classes and you get to know the teachers.
My favorite thing about Carroll is that everyone else here is dyslexic, and when you walk in the room, you have everyone in the classroom understand your dyslexia.
One thing that I like about Carroll is Fall Festival, and I also like getting to learn at Carroll School. And I like that how Carroll teaches me in a way that I know and I can learn, and I like being with friends too.
My favorite thing about Carroll is the community and the people.
I like Carroll because they just focus on one thing, dyslexia. It is a great community. You make lots of friends, and they don't care about fastness. You can take your time.
I love Carroll because I like understanding what I learn.
My favorite thing about Carroll is the caring community and the nice teachers.
My favorite part about Carroll is being around all my wonderful colleagues and laughing with all of them.
I like Carroll because gym is fun.
My favorite thing about Carroll, that's really easy to learn and they make it really fun.
I love Carroll because it makes me feel like a big family. We're all pretty much the same and we all have the same disabilities, so it's like a big family.
And I have to echo our students and say my favorite thing about Carroll is our community, and having you here with us this morning has been such a pleasure and such a benefit to have so many of you join us from so far away. Though I hope we can all see each other in person soon, we are just so grateful that you could be here. Should you have any questions, do feel free to email us. We're always happy to answer them. But until then, we wish you all a lovely day.